Welcome to the ERL seminar. Today's speaker is Jakob Mann from the Technical University of Denmark. So Jakob got his PhD from Aalborg University in 1994, and since then he spent most of his time at the Technical University of Denver, first as a PhD student, a scientist, senior scientist, research professor, and now he's a full professor of the wind energy and atmospheric turbulence. And he's got numerous prizes and awards, for example, the European Academy of Wind Energy Scientific Award. And he's also the executive editor of Environmental Research Letters. And quite recently, he has co-founded a new journal, Wind Energy Science, and he's currently the editor-in-chief. And so with that, we are looking forward to hear about the European Wind Atlas.
Thank you very much. Well, I forgot the... Does this change the... I have to go over here. Okay. I better move this hand. Okay, thank you very much for the introduction. So I'm going to tell you about the new European Wind Atlas project and try to give you an overview of what that is. So the purpose is accurate mapping of wind conditions for resources and also to some degree loads all over Europe in high resolution and with much lower uncertainty than that we usually see. And in order to do that, we need to develop and test a chain of models to do it. And in order to see if those are right, we need a series of atmospheric field experiments to validate these models and the atlas. But in reality, those work in more or less parallel, so much of the field campaign, they just ended by the end of the project, so they couldn't be used to verify the model chains. So actually, and then we used existing data to assess the quality of the wind atlas. Okay, so these are the EU countries. Soon this will not be green any longer. So these are the partners in the project. We headed the project and we had a lot of partners in Germany, Belgium, Spain, Portugal, Turkey, Latvia, and Sweden. And actually, England also wanted to join the Met Office, and they thought they had a go, but suddenly they got a new government and they didn't believe in renewable energy, so they just scrapped it. Yeah. Okay, so the Atlas will cover these EU countries and also offshore out to roughly 100 kilometers from the coast, also including the North Sea, which is a huge wind energy area, and the Baltic. They both have shallow waters and very suitable for wind energy. The North Sea can kind of cover all the electricity consumption of the EU if we put enough turbines up. And then we have these experimental sites where I'm going to talk about Padigao, a little bit about Kassel and Hornemosen in Sweden, and Alaith. I'm not going to talk about the two Danish sites here. I could do that another time, but that's an offshore investigation of winds close to the shore, the first 7 kilometers from the shore. And Østerild is our test station for very large turbines where we have two 250 meter masts where we scan the flow in a 5 by 5 kilometer area to look at kind of large scale fluctuations that affects wake mandarin. Then we also had a ferry mounted lidar, profiling lidar, going forth and back between Kiel in northern Germany and Lithuania, Klaipeda in Lithuania, making one transect in 24 hours roughly. So we could compare that with mesoscale models. I'm not going to talk about that either, and not about some masts in Latvia. So the project is what is called ERANET Plus project. It stands for European Research Area Network. And whenever you see this, you shouldn't touch it. It's horrible bureaucratic monster. The idea is that the EU will provide 33% of the total budget, while all the agencies in the member countries, they will provide the rest. And they have different rules, and it's really a mess. So it's not a super great idea from my perspective. It takes a lot of work from the administrator for the project. The total budget is around 12 million euros, and duration is 4 years and 2 months. And roughly the budget is 50% for experiments, 30% to develop the model chain, and 20% to produce the atlas. And yeah, the project has ended, and it was kind of released. Atlas was released in Brussels in June, and you see all the many partners, 30 or something. I'll start with experiments. The largest campaign is the Patagao experiment, which I believe you have heard about, and Robert Menke will tell much more about it later this year. He's an ASP visiting PhD student from DTU. It has a lot of masts, 50 masts, 190 sonics, 20 scanning lidars, 7 profiling lidars, profilers, balloons with radiosondes, radars, microwave radiometers, and it was a joint venture, you could say, between the new European Wind Atlas and the American side. The American side was National Center for Atmospheric Research, basically Steve and a lot of co-workers, Notre Dame University, Joe Fernando was heading the application for National Science Foundation, Berkeley with Tina Chow, University of Colorado with Julie Lundquist, Cornell with the ladies, Rebecca and Sarah, Oklahoma with Peter Klein, and also Army Research Lab was not a part of the National Science Foundation application, but they came in and provided their own funding. In Europe, it was not all the NEVA partners that participated. It was Portugal who hosted the experiment, us and Germany. And then apart from the new European Wind Atlas project, Deutsche Luft- und Raumfahrt joined, Enercon, a wind turbine manufacturer, University of Stuttgart, Leosphere, a LIDAR manufacturer, and National Center for Atmospheric Science in the UK. And they all provided their own funding, and the deal was that they shared their data and we shared our data. And that also worked in this way, that we didn't really got involved financially in each other's. We just said that we wanted to share the data, and then we figured out who's going to pay for these masts, who's going to pay for these instruments, and it actually worked out very well with no lawyers signing documents or anything. I think it's fantastic collaboration between Europe and the United States. So you may also know the rough layout of the experiment. It's kind of hilly area, but it has two distinct ridges here, and then they are equipped with a lot of instruments, towers along each of the ridges, towers along the bottom of the valley, and transects with towers, and you know, various profilers, and you can all look at this at the University of Porto's website on the experiment. Okay, so what research has come out of Patagao so far? Yeah, all the data are available through ENCA, but also University of Porto and DTU. And we have this overview paper published in May on the experiment in BAMS. And there we show some of the nice measurements we've done. I mean, these are kind of earlier measurements. They're not from the main campaign, they're from a pilot campaign, but you see the, no, they are from the main campaign, 2017, yeah. You see these low level jets and they hit the ridges and they start to oscillate, like trap Lee waves, or, and you see hardly any velocity up here, just minus 1 meter per second, but here you see quite a lot of speed. And then Jose Palma and co-workers in University of Porto, they have modeled that based on WARF and coupled to their microscale model Ventus to kind of reproduce this. I mean, this went very well for these stable conditions. Later on the day, didn't went go that well, but it's if you have trouble sleeping, then we have uploaded, a robot has uploaded a half-hour video of all the measurements over 24 hours, so you can enjoy that. We had a news article in Nature, actually more or less during the experiment, and then we had a lot of papers, around 20 now, I think, but we have 10 papers in an interjournal special issue on the experiment. An interjournal special issue, that's three journals, Atmospheric Measurement Techniques, Atmospheric Chemistry and Physics, and Wind Energy Science, that goes together and have made this, this special issue. And one of the results, which was headed by Robert, is this study of wake behind the turbine, the isolated turbine on the ridge. And this is actually one of these nightly jets that oscillates, but here you see the wake from the turbine. And if you look at kind of the angle by which this wake goes away from the turbine, then in the night it goes down minus 20 degrees here, and in the day it goes up. And that reflects the fact, we believe, that then you have recirculation and then the flow goes more up like that. And people have tried to model this wake in complex terrain with actually NCAR's LES model. That's a collaboration with DTU and NCAR on that. So far not including stability very much, but this is a neutral flow. That's others. This is Rebecca Pathelmi and Sarah Pryor. They have also scanned the wake in Paddy Gow, and they see here as a function of time of the day. Here's the stability. So here's zero, and here's negative Monoco parameter. So it's unstable during day, and then stable during night. We agree on that. But then they look at how does the wake move relative to the hop height position. And they see if you go close by like 2 diameters from the turbine, it goes up in night and not so much up during day. And if you go further downstream, you see that during night it goes more up, and then during day it goes more down. So it's 100% or 180 degrees different from our results, but I don't know what happens here. So it's sometimes very difficult to analyze these scanning LiDAR data. It requires a lot of work, and I don't know if what has happened here. Yeah. Then people have tried to downscale with quite a complicated model. Like here it's a WARF LES, I believe, from Johannes Wagner from DLR. They have a zooming grid, and then they resolve the inner part here with 200 meters resolution. And what they learn is that on top of the ridges, they can predict fairly well the wind climate during the campaign. But in the valley between the two ridges, the wind rows is not correct. And the same was done by PhD student at DTU, Bjarke Tobias Olsen, who also looked at wind profiles and wind roses at top of the southwest mast in the valley and on the northeast ridge. And these are just the wharf profiles, and then they're coupled to a microscale model called Ellipsis 3D that includes temperature stratification. And here are the measurements during the intensive campaign of the experiment. And he can get a very good comparison with the models. The wind roses, however, I mean, they're okay on the top of the ridges. They align more or less perpendicular to the ridges, but in the valley, I think it's also at 100 meters, the measured wind rose is more along valley, while the model is more perpendicular to the valley, so not everything works. Another thing is looking at the recirculation zone, which again Robert has done a lot. And here you see two lidars scanning into the valley, and the line of sight velocity with sign swap, so they get the same sign, the two lidars, one is standing here, one is standing here. And you see the flow comes in like here, quite steady, strong 12 meters per second. And then you see here, there's a negative velocities, and then we characterize the recirculation zone, the extent of the recirculation zone as this area or this length here from the top. And what we showed there was that, okay, it depends a lot on stability. When it's unstable, the zone is larger. When it's stable, it's smaller. It also depends on where in the valley you are. It changes systematically. The valley bottom shape is changing gradually, and you can see that in the length of the recirculation zones. And then it's just up to some modelers to kind of reproduce that. We haven't seen that yet. Okay, so that was very shortly about the Patagao experiment. Here's another experiment. It's in Germany. And it's about a forested hill. So here you have tree height up to 30 some meters, a forested hill, and then it's surrounded by fields, and that corresponds to the position of a hill here, 200-300 meters higher than the surroundings. Here we have measured the flow around it, and we are currently trying to make a blind test, so not releasing too much information about the experiment, but inviting modelers to predict, say, the wind profiles or for a certain day or a certain wind direction, and then compare those to get an impression of the uncertainty that is associated with the modeling. Here's another experiment in Sweden. And it's again quite a different terrain. It's rolling hills here, the heights, equipped with a lot of profilers. Many of them are sodas, some are lidars. There's also a 180 meter mesological mast in the middle. And if you look at the canopy height, all experiments in this project they have aerial scans, so we know the height of the canopy, the exact position of the ground, the density of the canopy everywhere. But here we show the height of the canopy, and you can see that it's really industrial forestry. There's a lot of high pieces of forest and lower pieces, and there's some lakes and there's some agricultural fields, so really patchy terrain, and that gives some challenges for modelers. So it's also we're also running blind test on this experiment. The last experiment I'll talk about is in northern Spain near Pamplona, where the National Center for Renewable Energy has a test station for wind turbines on this ridge. So this ridge is 500 meters relative to the valley. So this is a ridge here, and then there's another ridge from which this photo is taken, which is maybe 150 meters tall, and the distance here is 6 kilometers, I think. So it's larger scale, larger elevation than Perdigão, and that larger elevation causes lots of clouds on top of this ridge. So we couldn't put the wind scanners on the top of the ridge because then it'll be in the clouds. So they are put in the valley. We have had five scanning lidars in the valley. Here's the map again. Here are the five wind scanners. Two of them are scanning on the ridge here, the wind at 125 meters above the ridge, and two other scanners are scanning down here on this ridge, and then sometimes three or four scanners are scanning along this transect. So we'll have the relative wind speeds of the two ridges and what is going on in the middle. Then we also have some soda with RAS, and it's here, and we have some 80 meter masts, meteorological masts, and these are flux stations, very short flux station provided by Universidad de los Baleares on Mallorca. And you can see here that this is the wind rose for over some years, measured from this mast. It's either from north or even from south, so it's going this direction almost all the time, at least on top of the ridges. And here's some, here you see the picture again, and the two scanners here between the 500 meter hill and the 150 meter hill, and they scan in these areas, and sometimes the wind comes from north over the little escarpment here, and we see stronger winds in the lee side of the hill going down, and it start to oscillate a little bit. So this is blue means wind in that direction, not so much wind up here. And sometimes it blows from the south, and sometimes you see this amazing stable flow here, and then some kind of, I don't know if it's a hydraulic jump or what it is going on here, really disturbing the flow. And Javier Sanz from CNER and Pedro Santos from DGU, they are working on trying to collect modelers to model some of those situations. Okay, but that was all the experiment. Not much of those have been used directly to produce the atlas because they finished too late, and everything takes time. The project was only 4 years, so 4 years in length. So here's the model chain. And there's one open source model chain. It's the NEVA setup of WARF, you could say, and then it's a open foam library and unsteady RANS force with tendencies, so kind of body forces given by the WARF, and everything is available on GitHub. And then there's a production chain, again the same setup of WARF, which is publicly available. And because of limitations in how much we could do, we have downscaled to microscale with WASP, which is a linearized model. We also have a nonlinear model called CFD WASP, but we couldn't run that everywhere in Europe. And that's then it's scaled down to a 50 meter grid. And we're not doing the downscale from the mesoscale fluctuation to the microscale every instant, so it's statistical downscaling. Over here you can do it all the time. You can have a time series produced by this model chain. But I'm going to talk a little bit about how WARF was set up. We had some test domains in Europe. Five test domains reflecting the participants, and that was necessary in order to understand how to run WARF to get the same results. That was not trivial in the start. There's people with many different length of experience in the project. And then we started to vary things in Wharf to kind of find out how to do the big run of all Europe in 30 years. So one thing is how often should we restart Wharf? So we tried from 1 day to 8 weeks, and 8 weeks was too long. I mean, it kind of wandered off somehow, and 1 day it was too short. So and how do we force the domains? Should we force the outer domain or just or all the inner domains? And how is the forcing done? There's all kind of things that affect the final wind speed in the end. What is the planetary boundary layer scheme or parameterization surface layer scheme? We tried also a lot of combination of those. We also tried two-way nesting, but it's much easier to do one way, so that was what we did. And then we forced the whole thing with different reanalysis data sets. Finally, a very important thing was turned out to be the sea surface temperature. How was that? From what product would you use there? And that made a difference on the wind speeds. And also similarly, surface roughness data sets. I mean, you have some, what we did was to use land use from Corinne, but they had to be translated into roughnesses or something, and that also affects the final wind speeds. So so I cannot go into all the different combinations, but you see quite a lot here. And then those, we ran all those for 1 year, 2015, and compared the mean profile to measured mean profiles in flat areas, because Wharf obviously does not take into account the details. So we wanted to go offshore or very flat areas like Cabau in the Netherlands. And here you see our flat site Østerild in northern Denmark. All the models here agree pretty well up here at higher heights, up to 250 meters. At lower heights, something happens. Probably it's quite a rough area, and maybe the roughness was not set right in Wharf. This is a Cabau, a lot of spread, but all the models kind of agree within 3-4%, and compares well with the measurements. Here's the Fino platform in the North Sea, the Fino 3. It works quite nicely. And here's iMuden, or how do we pronounce that? iMuden, which is between the Netherlands and the UK. So except maybe for these lower heights and this lower position at Cabau, everything seems to work well. And then we selected the best of those. Yeah. Yeah, different boundary layer schemes, different surface layer schemes, different large scale forcing from reanalysis data, different translation tables for the land use into roughnesses.
One of those pop up as being the better.
And also, I mean, we changed the domain size and all the run length, all different kinds of things. So in the end, we ended up with these eight domains, or is it 10? Forgot. Okay, but that's domains that are they're relatively large, but we wanted every domain to cover a country. So Spain is covered here, France, Germany, Turkey, etc. Except Norway and Sweden, they're too long, so they had two domains, so that there's no transition effects within each country. But I must say that the overlap region, I mean, they were agreed very well, so I don't think there was a problem with that. Then we went to a church in Spain, where they happen to have a supercomputer. It's the praise that's partnership for advanced computers in Europe. They have this computer called Mare Nostrum, which is in, they had nothing to, they couldn't use this church for anything, so they put a supercomputer into it. And we were lucky to get a big grant, 57 million core hours on this, which makes us able to do a lot of, an entire ensemble of runs with different physics over some parts of Europe to try to guess the uncertainty. Or, I mean, I don't say that the difference in mesoscale runs would give the uncertainty in the final end, but it'll maybe tell us something about the uncertainty. And then also do the final run where we have a fixed setup and run everywhere over Europe in 30 years. That's actually something that industry people, they like, that they can download these time series and compare with their own data. So in the end, I mean, we've got this, this is, for example, the 100 meter wind speed average over Europe from this calculation. And yeah, we ended up with this with 10 inner domains that was with a shared outer domain with 3 kilometer resolution. We didn't want to make it finer because we had limited computational resources, also because all the boundary layer schemes are they're not tuned for finer resolution. And we used the ERA 5 as a large scale forcing, MYNN and Monioko scheme, and NOAA land surface model, Korean land use with a certain translation table, Austria sea surface temperatures, and we use spectral notching in the outer domain above the boundary layer. And then we did all 30 years in I think it was 8-day simulation where we threw away the first day and did one-way nesting. So just to see what we get, we compared with some other data that we have been using. That's satellite data from synthetic aperture radar that through some empirical relations can estimate the winds at 10 meters above the sea, for example. It looks at the backscatter from the satellite, and the strength of the backscatter tells something about how strong the winds are. So this is Crete in Greece, and we see some kind of jets going off the island and then less wind out here. So 18 meters per second down to zero. And in Dwarf at the exact same time, we see also some jets here, northerly winds, and some lee zones. It's not exactly the same, but you can kind of see some similarity. Another day, winds came from south, and due to whatever mountains there are here, you see the speed up around the island, and the wind looks like it's turning out here. Speed up here, no wind here, speed up. And you see somewhat the same pattern in the Wolf simulation, speed up and turning around the island and some lee zones, although they extend further than indicated by the synthetic aperture radar. So that's fun to look at, and also have westerly winds where you see stagnation in front of the island and some kind of wake structure with lots of wind here. And we see the same in the mesoscale, although at a maybe coarser resolution. So that's nice that we can see something modeled over these 30 years that we can also see from satellites. But more serious comparison is then when we downscale and compare with meteorological masts that are placed in wind energy relevant sites and wind in the relevant heights, that means from 40 meters and up to 200 meters maybe. And here we use this old WASP program that uses statistical downscaling. It has two models, an internal boundary layer model and a linearized flow model. They can be linearly combined. And then the downscaling process is then using the rudimentary terrain that is inside WARF and kind of remove the effect of that. And then subsequently apply the more detailed microscale terrain and apply the effects derived from that. And the terrain data sets, we used a viewfinder elevation on a 100 meter grid, Korean land use on a 50 meter grid, and then they are converted to roughnesses via some roughness conversion tables that are not so trivial. I mean, there's some in the literature, WARF is using some, and we had some interpolation between those based on also experience from our lab. So what that means, going back to our Crete example, is that this is WARF at 3 kilometer resolution, and when you have then apply WASP, you get on the sea, you get the same pattern, but on land you get much more details. You can see some ridges and some speed up on top of those ridges. Okay, so now comes the serious comparison. I mean, these are data that the wind turbine manufacturer Vestas have, and we didn't know those in advance. There were 291 selected masts in Europe based on high availability, and that they have measurements in this interval. And they also did some quality control. And you could see the distribution in Europe. They cannot disclose the exact positions, but they can disclose how it's distributed in Europe. You can see where the markets are hot, like Denmark, nothing is happening in Denmark. Poland is hot, Turkey is hot, France and the UK, and also Croatia for some reason. Oh, that's Bosnia and Herzegovina, sorry, and Italy. Okay, so and so here are the results. So we can only show distributions and distribution of selected groups of masts, but this is the bias. So this is if you just take error 5 data and say, or interpolate to the position of the mast at that height, and say what is the difference between that wind and the mean over at least 1 year measured. And of course you don't get it right, it's 1.5 meter per second wrong, so that's roughly 20%, which is a lot, and you get some distribution. Then if you apply WARF, then you get the mean bias is exceedingly small if you take all these masts. There's still some variation, 0.78 meters per second, which corresponds roughly to 10%. And then in the end, we apply the microscale, then it's not much better. It's actually the mean is worse. The standard deviation is not better. So still we are left with like 10%. So but let's have a closer look at these data. Yeah, WARF performs extremely well, we will say. Downscaling does not improve very significantly at all. But let's have a look at here the observed data, here the model data. Here are ERA 5 as a model. WARF is orange, and WASP plus WARF plus ERA 5 is a green point. So this is the same as you saw before, that WARF works very well. Microscale downscaling is not improving things really here. But let's try to look at different categories of masts. So here we look at what you call RIGS, ruggedness index. So it's simply the fraction of slopes within 3.5 kilometers that has a slope more than 16.7 that corresponds to a slope of 0.3. So we know that if the slope is larger than 0.3, then linearized models are not so, doesn't work that well. Okay, but so here at RIGS equal to 0%, we have 110 masts, and what we see here is that, okay, now WASP has a slightly smaller standard deviation, nothing really impressive. The mean bias is a little bit closer to zero compared to WARF. And if you go to medium RIGS between 0% and 2%, then WASP is not starting to work very much better. It has less standard deviation, but the mean bias is not better. And if you go to high RIGS, so complicated terrain, then not surprisingly, WASP overpredicts the wind by 0.6 meters per second. It's because if you have a hill and a mast on the hill and it's steep, then generally linearized models, they overpredict the speed up. So it's not so great. I think I would hope that it would go further down, but of course we try to experiment with things, and one striking experiment was that we changed the roughness translation table quite drastically. So we have this roughness translation table from Corinne land users, and we simply multiply our roughness translation table or with either half, one, or two. And what we see here is then, okay, so this is the bias on the mean wind speed for all categories, and this was what we saw before. If you half the roughness, then you get a worse comparison, but if you double the roughness, you get a better comparison. The mean bias is smaller. And then here it's divided out on low, medium, and high roughness terrain, you could say, or ruggedness index, so steepness of the terrain. And it seems that kind of all the time the higher roughness is better. If you look at the power, so you put the winds through a power curve, I haven't talked much about that, but here it's all even more obvious that, okay, increasing the roughness by a factor of two, which is not unreasonable for, if you estimate roughness, you can easily go wrong a factor of two. Then rougher is better, apparently, but it's kind of beyond what people usually estimate as roughness. But yeah. All right, then in the end you can look at winds and power and also temperatures and looking at there's an atlas, you can zoom in here and look at different layers, different heights, and you can look at the micro scale. This is a mesoscale data. You can look at the downscale data. I would like to probably come back to. So there's this interface where you can also download data and time series from this interface. Okay, so in conclusion, we have a validated atlas with 50 meter resolution over Europe. We have 30 years of mesoscale data available on a 3 kilometer grid from this period. And we have a lot of data from atmospheric experiments that are used for model testing and modeling, model improvements. They have not been used directly in the creation of the atlas, unfortunately. And we have an open chain model, open source model chain based on OpenFOAM and WRF, and the setup of WRF, which is very important. And downscaling to microscale leaves room for improvement, I think. It could be either be that the roughnesses that we extract from various sources are not correct. Also a land use, I mean, a field in Portugal and a field in Poland, they may be very different. We should have a more objective way to characterize the roughness, for example, by some satellite products or lidar scans of the whole thing. Another thing is we've seen stability is important. Do we include that correctly? And we've also seen that, big error is from the linearization of the model. High ruggedness index sites, they have a larger error. So there's a room for improvement here. So yeah, so that's it. And I'd like to thank Inka for appointment as a field scientist. And I'd like to thank all the different funding agencies and partners that have contributed to this project, which I have only presented a small fraction of. So thank you very much.
I was just when you showed the biases and the errors and things like that. If you dug a little bit deeper, is there a stability influence in those errors? Is it bigger during the day or the night or something like that?
Well, we have dug deeper in many ways. We have looked at how stability statistics is affected by all the input to the mesoscale model. And that's quite a lot. We have also tried to do some neural or some machine learning to figure out what parameters are affected. And then the strongest two, I think, is latitude and longitude. I mean, that I don't really understand why that came out that way. But I mean, we haven't looked at. I mean, we could take day hours and night hours and compare those. We haven't done that yet. That's a good idea.
I was also curious about, you mentioned it. Has anyone said, oh, I want to do AI with this thing, machine learning and all that stuff?
Yeah.
If you could just comment on that.
Yeah, we have done some ourselves with Bjarke. Tobias Olsen did that and try to figure out where does the error come from. Can you point us to the direction? And that was the result was it was latitude and longitude. Again, we can't really use that for anything. So.
There was errors.
But there was also indication that roughness had something to do with it.
Yeah.
Do you have any other questions?
Thanks, Jakob. So in the Perdigao conversation, you talked about flow separation and its variability up and down the valley. Mm-hmm. Did you look at how that varied with the surface roughness in this vein of if there were tall trees in that region versus if it was the region where the turbine was versus regions where it was vineyards instead of the big trees?
I don't see a clear trend in roughness through the valley, but we see that towards the southeast end, the valley floor gets a little bit up. So it's shallower valley, and that's where the recirculation zone is shorter. I don't know, maybe Robert, you have some comments on this, whether there's some gradient in roughness?
Well, having stood on the
data, but from being there, the experiment, I wouldn't say that there's an obvious gradient.
Well, but there was that region, I mean, I've been on the hill, and it was there was one region with tall eucalypts all throughout, and then it was shrubs down behind the turbine, if I remember correctly. And anyway, I was just curious if you sort of looked at that variability at all.
I don't think anyone has actually simulated the area with the correct roughness. I mean, the correct distribution of roughness. They have had uniform roughness and changed that up and down, but I don't know if anyone yet has taken our scanning data where we have all the three tree heights and put that into models. It's something we miss to do, or somebody misses to do. Yeah. Yeah, I've done it many, many times, but first he wants to have simple roughness and then simple boundary condition, then neutral, and so I'm
we have more questions? Okay, then let's thank Jakob again.
Okay, thank you.